Hello, this is Mark Gonley with Chicago Tap Theater. Here about to kick off a new episode of the Tea on Tap today, featuring one of my very favorite tap divas, the Miss Star Dixon. Let's kick this off as we do every week with a little Tea for Two and Miles Davis the Pug. Oh, thanks for joining us. We'll be starting the episode very soon.
Just me for you and you for me alone. Nobody near us to see us or hear us. No friends or relations on weekend vacation. We won't have it known, dear, that we own a telephone, dear. We'll break down.
Nick, you are definitely a tap diva also.
For you to take for all of boys.
Hey, Donna. Hey, Kathleen. Good to see you.
We will
That is our little pug mix, Miles Davis. He always likes to kick off the show. Hey, Wendy Barker, nice to see you. Hey, Sterling. Question, is Miles gonna fall asleep before we start this episode? I see that our special guest has joined. She will be here in a hot second. I think right as she comes on, we will be able to fade out the lovely and amazing Ella Fitzgerald. And here we go. All right. Well, hello there. Let me turn
Hi.
This around.
Is the dog interviewing?
Hi there. That was... Here, let me turn this up. There we are. Hi there. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you. It's so good to see you.
You too. 2 days in a
hey,
row.
Hey, Lisa. Good to see you. I know,
Hi,
right?
Lisa.
And hey... And look at us, we're actually getting some sun today in Chicago.
I know. It's supposed to be like 55. I will be going outside later.
Yeah, we have earned that. We have earned some sunshine. So, Star Dixon, welcome to this episode of the Tea on Tap. Would you believe this is the fifth episode?
Thank you for having me.
Oh my gosh, it is such an honor. I think you know, because I tell you every single time I see you, which is relatively often, since we live in the same city, that I am such a huge fan of yours. You are one of those tap dancers that watching your success, watching your career take off, watching your chops just get astronomically amazing, it's been
you.
A real joy.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I feel like I still remember when you were, like, a kid, when you were, like, 9 or 10 years old. And it's so it's really been a journey. Yeah.
I'm like an adult now.
You are an adult. What are you drinking out of today, and what are you drinking?
Well, I've got my favorite mug here. It says, hello, beautiful.
Ah, how appropriate. And what you drinking there?
I am drinking one of my favorite teas. It's green tea with grapefruit.
Oh, that sounds good.
Dandelion, elderberry, ginseng. It's really good.
Mmm. That sounds amazing. So I always ask at the beginning of these, where are you right now? Are you are here in Chicago, correct?
Yeah, I'm at home, chilling.
Lovely. Do you mind giving us a little look around, you know, what does Star Dixon's pad look like?
This is my Mikasa.
Nice.
This is a bear from one of my students, Abby, for Christmas.
How cute.
Thank you.
Love it. Thank you for sharing with us. I always think it's cool to get kind of a little inside glimpse of how people live. Yeah. So the first question I always ask is this. Tell us about your first experience with tap dance. What do you remember being the first time you either saw it or experienced it?
I don't necessarily remember the first experience because I was so young. Obviously, I grew up. Burl Barrett is my brother. Shout out to Burl Barrett and Mad Rhythms.
Yeah.
So he was tap dancing. By the time I was born, he was already tap dancing. Huh? So, yeah. So he would just teach me steps at home. And I don't remember the first show that I saw, but I do remember the first show that I felt. And it was a Rhythm Is show. And that made me really want to be a tap dancer, seeing young Black women. And plus Sarah also being a woman, Sarah Sinelli also being a woman, but especially Idella Reed Davis and Sharon Reed being young Black women tap dancing.
Yes. You know, I remember when
that's
I first.
What I want to do, I want to be in Rhythm Is.
Yes. You know, when I first moved to Chicago, I remember asking people, where do people go to take professional class? This would have been in about 2000. And some people said, oh, we go down and take from Idella. So I went, and I remember it was some of the ETC folks, which is an old Chicago tap company. I think Brill and or Trey were there. Jay Fagan was there. I mean, it really, like, when the professionals in Chicago wanted to go train, I remember thinking, like, oh, this is the person who trains all the, like, professionals in town. And her class is amazing. I think she's one of those names that should be bigger than it is. Because she made such a contribution to this art form. And yeah, if you've never seen Rhythm Is. Mm. And you got to perform. Am I correct? Were you were there at the reunion?
Yeah. So that was pretty amazing to be a part of, to share the stage with those women that inspired me so much, the women that came before me, and then some of the women that inspire me now that I've been coming up with. So it was pretty cool.
Yes. I'm always interested, you know, one of the core principles of tap dance is this idea of lineage, where we come from, who our teachers were, our mentors. And for me, I'm always fascinated, not just on our teachers, but our grand teachers, right? Who are the teachers of our teachers? Can you tell us a little bit about some of your lineage?
So obviously Burl was my first teacher, and then Trey, Martin Dumas III, and Jemani Taylor. Jemani is a product of Sammy Dyer, where I know he was a student of Idella's. He was a student of Brill's. I don't remember who else he was a student of. Maybe Ted Levy. I don't remember all who all was teaching tap back then before I was there, because I didn't go to Sammy Dyer until I was in high school. And then Martin comes from Mayfair. And so that's Tommy Sutton's legacy. And Brill's first tap teacher was a man by the name of Carlton, I don't know anything about Carlton. Like, I don't know if he's still alive or anything, but he was a teacher at the Better Boys Foundation, which is a youth center that was in our old neighborhood. And so he had Carlton, and then he had Mr. Taps, who he used to street perform with, and that was like his mentor coming up before he was at Sammy Dyer.
Is there anything that a mentor has ever said to you in your life that you still think of?
So I always tell people this. I'm not good with remembering words. I'm better with remembering actions.
Then tell us about it. Is there an action that has stuck with you after all these years?
So coming up under Brill, he just basically set out the blueprint for me to be able to do what I love for a living.
Wow, that's deep.
As far as I know, with him creating Mad Rhythms and then creating the Mad Rhythms Tap Academy and then the After School Matters program. And he's also been a constant reminder to always make sure you are bringing back what you learned to your community. Don't just take it and go. The most important part is bringing it back and keeping it in the community, because it's something that we need so much. Mm.
What is it about tap dance that kind of first struck a spark with you? What is it that, like, keeps you getting on that board every day? What is it that you love about tap dance the most?
I love the expression of it. I love the not having rules, just being able to get on a board and do what I want to do. I always felt like I've been really not kind of bad with expressing myself verbally. So it's definitely been something that helps me get out what I want to say.
Mm. And that is so important. Mm-hmm. And I've seen you dance, so it is obvious you have a lot to say. That is for sure. This is always interesting to me. What does technique mean to you within the context of tap dance, right? Dancers throw around the term technique all the time. Mm-hmm. And yet I feel like it's easy to define maybe in the context of ballet. Uh-huh. But I feel like in tap, technique is maybe a more open term, or a term that we can kind of define on our own. What does technique mean to you within the context of tap dance?
I feel like technique is foundation. Just like we have with languages, we learn words. And we learn how to put those words into sentences and learn how to put those sentences into paragraphs and make complete thoughts and expressions and tell a story. So I feel like it's the same thing. Your technique is all of the shuffles and the flaps and the cramp rolls. And it's up to you what you do with the technique that you have been given. Mm.
Do you, and maybe you don't have these days, but do you ever have those days where you feel like you should be hitting the wood, but you're just not feeling it for one reason or another? You have those, what do you do on those days? How do you deal with that?
I have days like that, especially because I feel like I'm teaching so much that I'm not working on myself as a tap dancer, because mm-hmm. I'm so involved with teaching. And sometimes it's overwhelming. And then I feel like I'm not doing my best at creating, because like my brain is tired. And so I'm not able to put forth my best foot because I'm just tired.
So yep. There's only so much water in the well.
Times like that is when I really just dig in and watch footage, because everybody is really inspiring to me.
Yes. Oh, that's a great answer to that. When you feel like you don't want to dance, put on some footage and watch the people that came before us. I like that.
Yeah, they're always inspiring.
Mm. Have you ever had to come back from a major injury of any kind?
Thank the Lord, I have not ever had any major injuries. Only I've had a couple of knee issues where I had to like take a little break, but never anything serious, thank God.
That's awesome.
I don't really know what I would do if I had a serious injury. Like, it was hard enough for me to take that week break.
Yeah. Well, I can tell you from you being the fifth interview, I've asked this of every single guest. Most of them were a little older, and most of them had some injury, and they all came back, and they all came back and danced better than they had before. So as scary as it is, like, that's why I always ask that question. I think we all need to know that, like, we can survive this, and that mm-hmm. as scary as those things are, that there is an answer to, you know, that will come out of it on the other end usually. I'm also interested in the concept of regionality. How do you think that your dancing is influenced by the fact that you're from Chicago? And I think for you, probably more specifically even, how is your dancing shaped by coming out of Mad Rhythms?
So being a part of Mad Rhythms, we are very heavy into improvisation. So it's something that as soon as you start coming to Mad Rhythms, if you're 6 years old, first thing you're going to do is improvise. It makes it because especially when you're younger, you have like no fear. You're totally willing to just go in. You don't care about what people think. You don't care about if people laugh at you. You just want to express yourself and get it out. So that's the best time. So I've been improvising since whenever Brill started teaching me how to tap, and I would always say I hated it because wherever we went, if we were standing still, he would make me trade with him. So, like, if we were at the grocery store with my mom, she would always take a long, long time, and he would always have me in there improvising. If we went to a restaurant and we're waiting for our food, he would make me trade. So we are heavy into improvisation, and we listen to a wide variety of music, and because that definitely gets, especially when you listen to different stuff on a regular, it gets into your subconscious, and whether you remember that you were inspired by something or not, you are inspired by it, and it shapes the way you, it shapes your musicality.
Yes.
So we always start every rehearsal off with an hour-long improv circle. And so definitely dancing with a lot of people. It's funny because people always say, like, oh, you could tell you from Chicago. And we're like, what does that mean? We don't know what that means. But one time I asked someone what they meant by that who wasn't a tap dancer. And he said he felt like Chicago has like a rawness and like a grittiness to it. We've gone through a struggle type of thing, but we're still surviving, still going strong type of thing. And I was like, that's interesting.
A little bit of technical. There we go.
Okay, I'm back.
You are back. And also, hi, Kalina. Nice to see you.
Hello, everyone that's joining us right now. Hi. Hi, Kalina. Hey, Blue. Yes, Chicago all day. Imani.
Yes.
Guys, Bakari.
So you said that listening to different kinds of music is important. What are you listening to right now?
What am I listening to right now? What's the? Let me see what the last thing I downloaded.
And again, I apologize. There's just a little bit of technical interference, but that is okay. We will keep going. While we wait, I do want to say hi. Oh, there we are. You're back.
Okay, so I said the last thing I downloaded was a song called I'll Kiss the Sun by Sunny Christen, because I was talking to Diane Walker and she was telling me a story about Jimmy Sly and this song that just really reminded her of him. And then there was this whole backstory, this crazy backstory. So I was like, I got to get that song. So that was the last thing I downloaded.
Nice. I love it. So tell us a little bit more about coming from a family that danced. And you know what I can imagine, you know, as you said, there's this idea that you are constantly dancing together. It sounds like that was reality. Is that correct?
Well, especially when I was younger, it was more, more people in my family danced because, but before I was born, my mom danced with an African company that's still around today. And it's called Nejua Dance Corps, and it's African dance. Cool. And so,
fantastic.
So then when I was younger, she put me in African dance. And then, but a lot of my cousins tap dance. So I had like, my older cousins that are all the same generation as Brill. They all tap together. They had a group. And then they brought us up tap dancing. So me, J-Bo, and then my cousin Latrell. So we, and then my mom takes tap. So it's, yeah, it's really a family affair over here.
That's awesome. I'm a huge J-Bo fan. I mean, I think everybody is, but I just want to put that out there. Yeah.
He's a cool guy. He's cool.
Yes, very cool guy. One of the things that I've always appreciated about being a member of the Chicago community with you is I feel like more often than not, if I'm either having my own show or if I'm at another person's tap dance show, you are almost always there. Can you talk a little bit about the importance of being a member of a community and showing up and being there to support others? Because I think it's really cool that you make a point to do that.
Yeah, I think it's important to support tap because one, if we don't support it, we don't know how long it may stay. Like if there was no support, it's possible for the art form to die out because nobody's supporting it. So why would people want to continue to have it if nobody's going to support it? So I try to, yeah, I definitely, if I'm available and I have the energy, I try to make it to as many things as I can. And also because I know it's kind of inspiring, like, as weird as it is to me, like, I know that some people look up to me, and then it's the same, like, even people that are my generation, I look up to other people. So when I see them come to my shows, it makes me feel good. And so I want to be the same with other people.
Yes. That is amazing.
And I just don't want the community to be so divided. Like, I'm like, I just want to be everybody's friend.
I think you are. I think that's very accurate. So recently you've kind of delved into producing a little bit, right? And curating shows. Can you talk to us about that experience?
So last year was the first time I produced a show. It was, so every year we have the Chicago Tap Summit, and attached to it, we have our annual show that Matt Rhythms produces. So usually Brill is the brainchild behind it. And I may like choreograph a couple of pieces, but this time it was my show. I produced and directed it. And it was, oh man, it was a lot of work. And it was a lot of I broke down before the show because like just things were going wrong that I hadn't thought about, and things just weren't happening on time. And like, you know, as far as like people teching before the show, and just stuff was going wrong. And I was like, oh my God, what am I going to do? I left my laptop at home, and Sterling was nice enough to go drive in the rain to my house and get my laptop.
That man is a gem. He is one of my favorite humans. Yeah, huge shout out to Sterling. I love it. You know, but then what about the show itself? It ended up, after all the drama and everything.
The show itself was amazing. There was a lot of great feedback to it. And I just tried to relax before it. I had also had a lot of help. The stage producer, Audra, was very helpful. Phoenix, our lighting designer, was very helpful. Matt Rhythms was very, everybody was very helpful. So family is very important, because when you don't have it all together, they help you get it all together.
Indeed.
But the show is,
you know, any show Chicago Tap Theater does, there are literally like 50 people that make it happen. So I think the illusion that like there's that one person that makes it all happen, like people that don't do what we do, I don't think realize really what a heavy lift it is, and how many hands it takes to really make something magical happen.
Yeah.
So you're going to continue creating some new shows? Can we look forward to some new productions coming out of Star Dixon's?
Yeah, I would love to do it again, but we're kind of alternating around who does it and Matt Rhythm. Mm-hmm. So for this October, hopefully Donetta will be producing the next show. Like, so she's been working on that, and we just have to wait and see what's going to happen with the world. Hopefully we can get it done.
Yeah. Indeed. I would love to see what Donetta creates. That would be a joy. I love that. Tell us about your Tap for Tots program, because this is something I saw you post about it, and it blew my mind, because there's an interesting thing where those of us who teach as like a core part of our career that are also professional tap dancers, for some reason, the vast majority of us decide, oh, I don't want to mess with young ones, right? I don't have the patience, or I don't have the whatever. When I saw that you were making a conscious effort to teach the littles, it blew my mind. It inspired me, and it gave me like all this, like, I was like, of course, talk about raising the next generation. You are going to get them when they're first experiencing tap for the first time in their life. And what a great first experience to have with you as their teacher. So what inspired that? And what are you finding is coming out of that? What is it like working with those kids?
So obviously I don't have kids. I have two cats. So I can use that energy towards other kids, since I don't have kids at home to drive me crazy. So back when Mad Rhythms first started Tap Academy, however many years ago, I don't even know, a million years ago, I think we started at like 7 or 8 years old. But in the same building, when we were at South Shore Cultural Center, there was a toddler ballet program. And so, like, I would always be, like, friends and, like, playing with the kids in ballet. And then because some of them would have like siblings in the tap classes, so they're like hanging out with me while their siblings in class. So Britt was like, we should start a toddler class. And so that was when we first started the toddler class. And fast forward, I just, like, I went and I taught at this Dance Makers of Michigan, and I had a mini class, and they just, I, working with kids just brings me such joy. And I'm like, there's always going to be a million kids in the world. Why don't I start a program to broaden the range of kids, especially like in the city, like do classes, pop-up classes around the city so I can get more engagement for the class at Harold Washington. And I'm like, and we can make it a virtual thing because there are always going to be toddlers in the world. And I want everyone to experience what tap dance brings. Mm. So what better way than to start with toddlers?
I love it. Well, I'm so happy that you're doing that. I think it's awesome.
Thank you.
This is many people's favorite part of the Tea on Tap. Uh-huh. It's time for the 2-minute tap lesson. Okay. Star Dixon, you have 2 minutes to teach one step, concept, or idea. I'm looking at my watch. Go.
Wait, right now? I don't even have shoes on. Wait, let me put some shoes on.
All right, you get your tap shoes on.
I was like, where are my tap shoes?
I know, right? So I'm guessing, do you have a home studio? Like all of us, you have a home studio set up right now to teach in?
I have a board at home. Can you record this right quick?
Yeah.
Nice.
I'm going to give Time the phone.
All right. Hey, Time.
How you doing?
How you doing, Time?
I'm doing great.
Good. It's nice to see you.
All right. I'm ready.
Okay. Go ahead.
So this is just a little groovy little step that I love to do. And yeah, so we're going to do it. So you're going to take your left heel and your right dig at the same time. So you're going to go one, and then you're going to spank the right foot back, and then the left toe is going to go over. So you go one, two, one, two, three, four. One, two. Then you're going to tip heel, and then you're going to scuff, and then you're going to jump on the balls of your feet. So the rhythm goes one, two, three, four. You take that the
other way. Then you
can remix it. Ooh. And people just call it the star step because I don't have a name for it.
I love it, and you just had to hurt us with that triplet at the end, huh? You gotta warn us before you're gonna hurt us so hard with that triplet.
I was not ready for that, but that was the first thing that came to mind.
I love it. That is a brilliant 2-minute tap class. Thank you for doing that.
No problem.
All right, after the 2-minute tap class, rapid riffs. I have a series of 10 questions. Most of these, hopefully, are like 1 or 2 word answers. While I'm doing this, I want to give anybody watching, if you have any questions, this is about the time you want to start posting them. All right. That's a good idea. Yeah, we should both have a drink before we start this because it's intense. It's not really that intense. Yeah, like All right. Here we go. 1. What tap shoes do you wear?
Jason Samuel Smith and Capizio.
Taps. Do you like them?
K360. Go ahead.
Nice. Do you like your taps really tight or just a little loose?
Really tight.
Mm. Favorite song to dance to? You only get one song. What are you going to dance to?
Aisha by John Coltrane.
Favorite composer?
I've never thought about that. Oh, I don't know. I guess maybe it will have to be John Coltrane.
Nice. Yeah.
I gotta go back and think about that.
Just quick aside, have you ever listened to Alice Coltrane?
Yes.
I love her.
No, I have not.
She doesn't get a lot.
Talk about, but no, I have not.
Yeah, check her out. You know, she played organ, piano, and harp. And she recorded with John a little bit, but then also after he died, she devoted her life to exploring spirituality through music. She actually had an ashram in Santa Monica. She does this really gorgeous kind of jazz mixed with Indian instruments and really unique. So I always tell people, if you like John Coltrane, check out Alice. She's really something unique. You're doing a combo in 4-4 time. Do you count in fours or eights?
Fours.
Yes, thank you. Favorite tap dancer to watch who is no longer with us?
I guess I would have to say Chuck Green.
Favorite, oh, and here's, talk about spilling some tea, favorite living tap dancer to watch? This is a hard one for you. You got family that tap dance.
Favorite to watch? Yep. I think I would have to say Diane.
Yes. Favorite choreographed tap piece you've ever seen or done?
Oh man, this is hard because I've learned some crazy pieces.
No one said rapid riffs were easy. Hey, Philippe.
I think I'm gonna have to say a piece idea called Ultralight Beam.
Ooh, I've seen that piece online. I'm gonna tell everybody out there, if you have not watched this piece, it's been circulating on Facebook lately. Do yourself a favor and check it out. It is amazing. It is amazing. Yeah, I agree. That is a lovely piece.
I feel that one. I feel that one in the heart. It gives me chills every time I watch it.
What single tap performance that you've seen do you remember the most vividly? Like one thing on stage you saw that really made you, that just sticks with you.
Sorry, I'm taking so long. I've seen a lot of tap pieces.
Oh, I know. I appreciate you being thoughtful about these answers, too. So it's all good.
I think maybe I would have to say Savion in Portland. Because I was there.
Yeah.
You know, it's a different thing when you're watching a video and when you're actually there.
Yes, agreed. Agreed. You can go back. This is maybe my favorite question. You can go back in time and see any one tap performer or performance. Who do you see or what do you see? You can go back at any time in tap history.
The Hoofers line with Lon Chaney. Jimmy Slide. I forget who else is in it. Maybe, is it Bunny?
Nice. Best venue. This will be a hard one for you because you've played a lot of good venues. Best venue you've ever played?
Does it have to be about the venue? Because I want to say when I danced with Savion, because his floor is amazing and his mic system is amazing.
Yeah, you can definitely say that. You gave me your favorite floor to dance on. That's a good answer for a tap dancer.
I don't know what the floor was. Maybe it was oak. I don't know. But just the way it felt and sounded good.
Nice. How were you taught, or how do you choose to perform the second step of the shim sham?
Now, see, here's the thing. Because I was taught to pause, to hold the one. I mean, you know.
Yep.
But I've seen a lot of footage where they didn't, and then so it makes me really think about it, and it's like, if all the other steps start on four, what would be the reason for this one step?
Yeah.
Starting on one, and then the next step, bringing it back to the four. Like, I don't understand the purpose. So I don't even know anymore.
love it.
There's a pause.
Yes, I love it. So Star, I really have to tell you that I have been looking forward to this interview specifically, because I really have been quite a fan of yours for a while. One of the things that I want to encourage all of you out there, oh, I mean it so genuinely. I'm a huge believer that one of the ways we can make our artistic life more rich is to find people and organizations to be fans of, because you get a sense of investment, right? You pick one or two people that you always make a point to see, or that anytime you know they're doing something, you drop everything and you show up. And you begin to see them evolve over time. You see them have transitions in their career. You see them dance with different people, different musicians. And it's such a more rich experience than just seeing, you know, a different dancer everything. So I really want to encourage everybody out there to become a fan of somebody or something. Follow them, support them. If they're doing an Indiegogo, throw some money their way. If they're doing a show, buy a ticket. And Star, I just want to say in front of everybody here that I really am a fan of yours. I love what you do, and I love how you do it.
Thank you so much for that.
Aw. So before my final question, I want to thank Leah Koch and all of our amazing people in the marketing team. That includes Molly Alley. I also want to thank all the amazing dancers of Chicago Tap Theater. It's a hard time right now because we're not getting to really rehearse, and we don't know if our next show is going to happen. And we're dancers, right? We are made to dance. So I appreciate you all holding on and keeping the spirit of the company going. I want to thank my sound engineer and set dresser, Jennifer Yonley. Next, I want to announce our next guest. So coming up this Thursday, we have Sarah Petronio, straight from France. That should be a fun one. If you've ever had a conversation with Sarah, you know that she gets deep. So that's going to be quite interesting. And then next Sunday, a week from today, we have Michelle Dorrance. So that should be another fun discussion. I will tell you that Friday is book club, and we are starting a brand new book, The Soles of Your Feet, with Asia Gray. She will be on the Zoom. So if you've ever wanted to ask the author of a book questions, this is a great opportunity. Finally, I had a text conversation this morning with Chicago Tap Monster Nico Rubio. And we agreed, he and I decided together that today should in fact be designated as Star Dixon Day on the internet. So Nico is going to release the newest episode of the Real Talk Tap Talks today, featuring Star Dixon also. So if you didn't get your fill yet, and I'm sure you didn't, check that out. Nico's doing a great job with that podcast. I really want to give a shout out to that. So check it out today. And you'll get some more stories straight from Star's mouth.
Some throwback stories.
I can't wait, because you guys have a lot of history. You guys have danced together for decades now.
Yeah.
So, our final shuffle. When you shuffle off this mortal coil, how do you want to be remembered as a tap artist?
How do I want to be remembered? As someone who evoked emotion. Because, like, I feel like I'm an emotional person when I dance. And so I want you to feel, I just hope that people feel what I feel when I put it down.
Star, that is a beautiful way to end the episode. Thank you so much for being an amazing guest. Thank you for being a dear friend. Thanks for being a part of this community and making Chicago just a little bit brighter. You have a lovely day. Enjoy the sun.
Thank you.
I want to thank you. Yes. Thank you. And thank everybody for joining us. I sure appreciate you all being here. I will see you Thursday. Star, thank you so much.
Chicago.
Chicago.
Have a great day, everybody.